focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.
In today's globalized world, there are newer and newer kinds of risk. Black swan and gray swan events are happening a little too frequently. Given this kind of scenario, what do corporates do to insulate themselves from the vagaries of risk? Is there a way where they can maximize the profit and minimize the risk? Well, I have the man who underwrites risk, Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO of ICICI Lombard. Bhargav, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ravi.
Bhargav, we have been meeting on the subject of risk management for over 3 years now. Tell me, by looking at your own business portfolio and looking at the business landscape in the country, has the attitude and thinking of corporate India changed towards risk management?
You know, Ravi, I think if you look at over the last 3 years, my answer to your question would be that yes, there's definitely a greater level of awareness and sensitivity to risk management. And I think if you look at just the last calendar year, you talked about black swan events.
Yeah.
We've probably had three black swan events.
Yeah,
you look at the US election, you look at Brexit, look at demonetization.
Yeah.
You know, these are big, unpredictable events that no one could have expected. On top of it, you've had issues like the debit card, issue for financial services. You had in pharmacy, pharmaceutical industry, you had issues from the FDA. So we've had a number of events which probably people did not anticipate. And I'm seeing, as we speak, a lot more sensitivity, as I said, in terms of thinking through what are the events that people need to protect themselves for. The other big development, I would argue, is also the regulatory change. So if you look at Companies Act 2013, it also sets down some requirement, mandatory requirement in terms of risk management practices, etc. The SEBI, IRDA, RBI, all the regulators have been, Clause 49 of SEBI. So they have been kind of pushing industry in that direction. I'll give you one experience that we've had as an insurance company. So traditionally, insurance is about risk transfer.
True.
So you give me a premium, if nothing happens, I don't pay you anything. If something happens untoward, then I pay you a claim. So it's a risk transfer. 3 years back, we said that that's a very limited way of thinking about insurance. And if you see some global progressive insurance companies, they look at insurance as more of a risk management approach and risk mitigation approach. And that's how we kind of redefined our approach to corporates.
Okay.
We said, can we go to corporates and work with them to understanding what are the reason for risk, what are the reason for claims, and can we mitigate those risks? So move from risk transfer to a risk mitigation and risk management approach. It was a tough struggle at that point in time, if I may say so. But 3 years back, we got the first break with one FMCG client with whom we started working on their logistics chain using telematics to control hijacking risk, for example.
Okay.
Today, we have more than 250 clients who are working with us on that arrangement, not just on the telematics on logistics side, but across segments of risk, could be in health, could be in property. By property, what we mean is catastrophic or fire risks to their factories, also in transit. So we are clearly sensing a much greater awareness and inclination to look at risk mitigation today compared to what we had 3 years back.
So if I may say, bad news is good news for you?
Unfortunately, yeah. At times, that's how it plays out for insurance.
So is the risk management the top agenda on the board of every company today compared to 3 years back?
That would be overstating it. I don't think it's a top agenda, of the boards, but at least in most of the progressive companies, and we work with, almost all the large organizations in this country, we are seeing a sensitivity where the board is getting involved in some form of risk management. That's good news. Are we seeing, a comprehensive approach in terms of enterprise risk management and, the entire spectrum of risk controls and risk culture? I think we have still some way to go.
We saw earlier during Chennai flood a lot of cases of companies underinsuring. Is that correcting now?
So if you look at global benchmarks, the answer is again no. There is a big gap. So there are global benchmarks. Lloyd's comes out with an underinsurance report. and they bucket, you know, countries into three tiers in terms of levels of insurance, and we fall in the bottommost tier. And in terms of the benchmarking, our benchmarks compare with, we have Nigeria on top and Turkey and Egypt below us. So we have a long way to go, just to give you that as a perspective. And specifically on Chennai, if you look at the total economic loss that we faced as a nation, it was roughly about 45,000 crores. The insured loss, basically what was insured and how much we will pay out, would be roughly about 10%, a bit less than 10%, so roughly about 4,000 crores. So we have a long way to go in terms of coverage and insurance.
On that note, we need to take a short commercial break. We'll be back. Stay tuned. Welcome back. I'm with Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO of ICICI Lombard, and we are talking about risk management. How digitization technology is posing a significant challenge to the existing digital models. It's a disruptive strategy. We saw what Paytm has done. We saw what Airbnb has done. We saw what Uber has done. So, given this situation, how do you anticipate and fight such disruptions? And how do you de-risk your business?
The way we see it is, there's a lot of hype. And if you take that hype away, I think there is an underlying business model risk that most industries, particularly service industries, face, right? Attackers coming from outside the industry, the kind of organizations that you talked about. And technology today probably allows us to think exponentially. You know, we are traditional companies think linearly, you know, let's grow 15%, 20%. Technology can allow you to grow exponentially. People are thinking 10x. I mean, how do I, you know, improve my customer service 10 times? How do I scale my, you know, customer acquisition 10 times without having linear cost structure? And that's what technology is allowing you. And that's why business models are at risk of disruption, I mean, the point that you're making. I think the way at least we think about this is that there are a couple of things that, you know, organizations need to do. One thing that we find is, one, not all companies are thinking digital in the first level.
Okay.
And every business needs to think about their business as if it's a technology business in that particular industry. And they have to think digital. The second thing that we find is even companies that are thinking digital are thinking of digital in a silo. They're thinking about digital as a separate, addendum to their core business strategy. You know, we don't think that works. I mean, you know, in a sense, you have to think about digital as the core DNA of the organization for every element of the business, be it customer acquisition, which is where people think of putting up a, you know, e-commerce site, or, you know, that's where people think digital, but that's not everything that you need to do. You have to think digital for your internal organization processes. You have to think digital about your, distribution model. You have to think digital about, you know, sourcing customer insight through community, and you have to think digital about utilization of cloud opportunities. I don't think that's something that we
so
see.
So disruptive technology here to stay. Companies have to be nimble.
We believe so.
Okay. So, talking about digital, cyber attack, data breaches, online frauds are commonplace. We saw some 3 million debit card frauds happening because of hacking. So what, according to you, should corporate do to improve the risk environment?
Look, again, you know, this is an evolving area, and if you look at in the last 2 to 3 years, the number of large organizations that have been affected because of cyber attacks globally, forget the example that you gave just in India, these are very, very well regarded, you know, very progressive organizations who had very high quality internal security processes. In spite of that, they fell victim to some of these attacks. Having said that, I think in India, what we find is that even the basic level of work, we are behind the curve. I mean, there are some companies which, of course, have done a lot of work in terms of information security, in terms of incident response systems, in terms of the organization culture, because a lot of this is driven by the internal organization culture. So there is a lot of work that I think we in India need to do, but it's an uphill battle.
Globally, I believe boards are devoting more time to technological issues and cybersecurity. So what is the scene in India? Are the boards devoting time to this?
What I can tell you is that we are seeing a lot of interest from companies in terms of the cyber risk and how do they mitigate, you know, the cyber risk through insurance. So everything that I talked about in terms of having your own internal security policies and practices in place, what we find is most of the progressive companies are now seeking cyber you know, liability covers. That's a good trend. I mean, you know, 1 year back I wouldn't be saying that when we if we discussed this 1 year back. So there seems to be a greater awareness. Having said that, if the boards are involved, are we seeing that consistently across the industry? The answer is no. Are we seeing a consistent approach in terms of not only have the policy, but also put in the practices which make the policy a living document? That's a mixed experience. Some companies are, but most companies are not.
Two things I want to ask you. Listed companies go for risk management, or it's everybody? The universe is large.
Because you know, listed obviously, companies listed companies, if you look at a proportion of companies, a percentage of companies who go for, you know, risk management systems, it would be higher in listed companies. But that doesn't mean that small, you know, we find companies in unlisted space in terms of, you know, SME companies, we find some of the e-commerce companies very progressive in some of these areas, unlisted companies. So, you know, yes, you can generalize to say that listed companies are more conscious of risk management, maybe because of the regulatory reasons. But it's not necessarily true for that others don't.
So, have the technique for measuring various risks improved? Do you think there's enough talent pool in statistics and mathematics for sophisticated quantitative techniques for measurement of risk?
I think, you know, Indians basically have the talent, right? But I don't think we have enough institutes which are shaping their that raw talent into something that is consumable by the industry.
Yeah.
If you look at the educational institutes, there is one ISI and that's it. And you know, we hire from ISI, we hire from IITs, but there is you know, a finite number of you know, resources that we can tap into. And I think all of us understand that, you know, as they call it today, STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, these are the areas where significant educational investment and focus needs to be imparted. We are still stuck with, you know, building more IIMs. I think we need to spend a lot more energy building more ISIs and, you know, institutes which promote fundamental science. So the answer is yes, there is a bit of a, you know, gap in terms of the talent that we need as an industry.
So after all these years, despite so much of research, some claim that risk identification still remains an unscientific area. What has been your experience?
Today, data, analytics, and you know, new tools, new technological developments can be leveraged much better than what we could do even 5 years back. Any of this was not possible even 5 years back. And we are reasonably confident that the progress that we will see in any of these, each of these areas will be significant. And if you are thinking creatively of using some of these developments or progresses to, you know, get into the risk control and risk management side, you should see benefits.
Now, the government is bringing a lot of regulatory changes to improve transparency and promote ethical business practices. So, how should corporate equip themselves to manage risk arising out of regulatory changes? Now, let me share with you the latest KPMG survey, which says a regulatory risk is among the top 5 risks in the country today. What's your sense?
Look, I personally believe it's a big positive. I think if this country starts or corporates start behaving in a transparent and ethical manner, it's in the long-term interest of those corporates themselves. I'll give you, again, from insurance industry experience, what the regulator is forcing us to do, the IRDA. Over the last 3 years, they've been pushing a lot more disclosure, a lot more transparency in terms of customer service, in terms of our processes, in terms of our financials. And I've seen wherever there has been push for public disclosures, we've seen improvement in standards for the industry. Just for example, each one of us in insurance today have to disclose on our website what is our claims service TAT, as in how fast do you pay claims for each line of business.
Okay.
For motor insurance, how many claims do you pay within 1 month? How many claims do you pay within 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, and so on and so forth. And this is true for every line of business. I've seen the industry performance significantly improve over the last 3 years.
Probably because of the meeting the claims.
Meeting the claims faster.
Okay.
Similarly, there are disclosures on number of grievances that we have. And we've seen over the last 2 to 3 years, the percentage of grievances for the insurance industry have come down. as a percentage of the volumes of transactions.
So if I want to ask you, suppose when I look at the industry, the average was, let's say, 2 months. Has it come down to 15 days now? Would you say that significantly, or you say it's significantly come down?
So what has happened is a larger proportion of people are getting paid within 1 month, because the benchmark that has been set is how many claims do you pay within 1 month. So I'll give you an example. So for us in motor insurance, we settle 93% of the claims within 1 month. Industry average is about 63. But the 63 has moved up significantly over the last 3 years. So that's the point.
So
that
motor insurance is 93, but the healthcare would be faster.
Healthcare is 99% for us, for example.
Yeah, okay.
So, and that number is getting, you know, is moving up every year.
Every year, sure.
So the transparency.
You are bettering your own record.
Bettering our record, industry is bettering its own record. Okay. So that's a positive. So transparency, disclosures, we believe helps customers, and I think in the long run helps the industry itself.
Very well said, Bhargav. On that note, again, we need to take a short commercial break. We'll be back. Stay tuned. Welcome back. I'm with Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO of ICICI Lombard, and we are talking about risk management. So what are the best global practices that India can emulate?
So there are some global standards. There is ISO, the latest standard. There is a COSO standard, which people can adopt. But I think the whole aspect that we go and talk to our clients, we also talk to some of our clients on the entire ERM framework that we've kind of fine-tuned for ourselves with the risk dashboard that we've built. The moot point is, how do you ensure that at a board level, you made this point earlier, how do you ensure that at the board level there is a sensitivity to risk, and right from the top leadership of the organization, you are building a risk management culture which goes right down into the organization. And then you obviously look at setting the framework, setting tolerance limits and monitoring them on a consistent basis, so that you are moving ahead as an organization in a more positive direction.
Okay, now it is mandatory for the companies to put a strong framework of risk management. So technically speaking, a lot of companies could be setting up a department to meet the compliance issue. But the need of the art, to my mind, is to actively integrate risk management with the business strategy and growth. Do you see companies doing that in India?
Yes and no. What you're saying is absolutely right. You cannot have a risk management department, on the side and just use it as a checkbox that I've followed something from a compliance
box.
That's not optimal. But what we're finding is it's a mixed bag. Some companies are really thinking through risk management as a strategic tool, a strategic lever, and a lot of companies are using it as a checkbox.
Do you feel that embedding risk culture is a prerequisite for successful and effective risk management programs?
Absolutely. I mean, you cannot just talk about risk management at a board meeting and then the rest of the quarter ignore it and let the organization run amok consistently. So the entire organization has to understand the importance of risk management, and risk in a sense has to be embedded with business strategy. That's the only time and only way to make it work and sustain going forward.
What is the advice you'd give to corporate India in terms of risk management? If we do 1, 2, 3, 4.
I think coming from a financial services industry, we've seen a lot of value in enterprise risk management.
Yeah.
We were probably pushed to doing it because of regulation, but with time, we realize the value of doing it in a more sensible manner, with a lot more internal buy-in than just using it as a checkbox. And my, suggestion to the industry, to the corporate sector, would be to adapt some of these practices into their business strategy going forward.
Adapt and adopt, both. Bhargav, very well put. It's always a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ravi.
Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.